Well, it was the show that celebrated big shoulder pads, big hair, and some very big personalities. It broke new ground by having four older female stars talking about sex and dating over many, many pieces of cheesecake. As we have here, of course, it was the Golden Girls.
Let me tell you a story of the steamy South, a tale of deception and tragedy. Just a second, Uncle Remus.
Blanche is telling a story.
Oh, sorry, go on. I was 19. Fine. Oh, why? I thought she was finished.
She just said she was 19.
Well, look at her now. You don't call that a tragedy?
Still funny, writer Jim Colucci has all the secrets and the behind-the-scenes goss on the classic series for his book, Golden Girls Forever, and he joins us now. Jim, welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's so nice to be with you.
You are a super fan. You spent 10 years working on this book, which is just incredible. And despite their witty bickering on screen, the girls appeared to have the best of, you know, best friendship around. But is it true that in real life that they couldn't stand each other? Who was feuding with who and why?
I wouldn't say that they couldn't stand each other. I always compare a sitcom set to a family, and I think that if you were to visit any family on any given day, there'd be sibling squabbling, and that's kind of the way that I see it. I had heard rumors all through my research that Bea Arthur sometimes had problems with Betty White, and I had actually wondered how I would address that in the book, but and Betty was always so classy about maintaining that they all loved each other, which they did. Eventually, Betty went on American television and mentioned that Bea didn't always love her. And so I think she kind of broke the ice on that topic. I think that just they had very different styles of working, and sometimes those clashed. When you were really working at the top of your game and producing such a great show, knowing the world was loving it, you really wanted to give it your best. And their styles sometimes clashed, but they would eventually produce great art and get along doing it. There were stories about how Bea would wait for Betty on their dinner break on tape night and walk hand in hand with her to the dinner break. So they obviously made that chemistry work when they needed to.
Oh, that is lovely. Jim, another not so nice story that's doing the rounds is that Bea Arthur used to leave a little present, shall we say, in Betty White's dressing room toilet. Is there any truth in that?
I heard that same urban legend. I don't know if it's true, but yes, I heard that there was a story that Betty for a while would come in, I think after the weekend is the way the story goes, and find a present in the toilet in her dressing room. And they never caught the culprit who had been breaking in over the weekend to leave that present. Wow. But some people suspected it might be Bea. I don't know. I like that. I like it as an urban legend, though.
Yeah, so do I. Must have been those dastardly kids. Now, you've also described Bea Arthur as quirky and complicated. What does that mean exactly?
Bea Arthur was such a complicated lady, as I got to know from getting to spend time with her. Everybody assumes that because she was Maude and because she was Dorothy and they were tough broads, that you should play rough with her, that that was the way to interact with her. And that couldn't, it turns out, be further from the truth, because although Bea had that really imposing, tall exterior that you thought she was tough, inside, just millimeters inside, she was a mushball and very vulnerable, easily offended, and sometimes hurt by the jokes that the show made about Dorothy and her appearance. And so I found that it was best to treat Bea as a more vulnerable person and really respect her feelings and not play rough with her, as people assumed. And once you did, I think, once you made a good impression with Bea, she was such a loyal friend, she was yours forever. And I really felt like we bonded so well during this process, but it took a few phone calls before that happened.
Ah, now you say it took a few phone calls. Was she ever unpleasant to you?
There was a moment where I first asked her to do the interviews, and she first flat out said no, but at the end of every phone call, because it took several where I almost felt I had to phone stalk her, and I felt weird about doing that with this 80-something-year-old woman and her home number. But at the end of every phone call, after saying no, 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 I don't want to talk about it, she'd say, well, why don't you call me again and we'll talk some more? So she warmed up at the end of every call, and that's why I say complicated. I really felt like it was a trust issue with Bea, and she needed to know you weren't going to hurt her or ask her questions about why was Dorothy called ugly in jokes. And then it really became a matter of once she trusted me, she really opened up.
Oh, that's terrific. Now, what is this about Estelle Getty? She was only ever supposed to be a guest star, but the audiences, they fell absolutely in love with her, as we did. But then she had some problems remembering her lines. Now, did that cause some problems on set?
It did cause some problems. Estelle was a fascinating case study because here was a woman who had spent her life raising children and went into acting professionally really late in life, did get some off-Broadway work in New York, but really made a name for herself in Torch Song Trilogy, which was Harvey Fierstein's play, which went to California, which is how she got noticed by casting directors. So by the time she got to the Golden Girls, she was playing in the big leagues with three people who had been in television for decades, and she was brand new. And I think that when in theater, where the script doesn't change, you can nail those lines in your memory and then play the rest of the time. Once you know the lines. Television is the complete opposite, especially sitcoms, where your lines change every day. And I think she was really intimidated being among all these veterans and having her lines change. And then what happens with fear? It feeds on itself. Mm-hmm. Once you tell yourself, I can't do this, then you start messing up. And the way that it caused some friction was they would have to wait until the audience went home some nights after taping and let Estelle redo some of her lines. And it caused the rest of the women to have to work later on those tape nights when they were already tired. And I don't think that they understood back then that Estelle may have also had some physical memory problems going on, which we now know. And so it caused some friction, but I would say minor, because of all of them, I think Estelle was the glue that held them together. Yeah. Estelle was beloved by one and all. And so she, I think they forgave her those issues.
Now, Jim, I think I've got something in common with Bea Arthur. They ate a lot of cheesecake on the show, and I hate cheesecake.
Yes.
So did she, didn't she?
Yes, and I found that out through this interview process. I, of course, always watched the show, and it made me hungry. I wanted cheesecake. And they all had different takes on even the cheesecake, which was funny. You know, when I talked to Betty White, she talked about how actresses train to fake eat food and push it around the plate and pretend during a take and then get rid of some. And she was funny because she said about Rue, who was a good friend of hers, so she was teasing. She said Rue McClanahan took that show as a license to steal when it came to eating. Rue would just eat the cheesecake with abandon and pretend it had no calories because it was for the greater good of the show. B, turns out, hated cheesecake and was suffering all that time.
Oh, that's why I'm eating all this cheesecake. Now, when you think of the Golden Girls, you instantly can't stop thinking of the theme song, right? Thank you for being friend. Come on, guys. Travel down the road and back again. Gee, we're good. But you say in your book that the original theme song was supposed to be this. That's Bette Midler's Friends. What happened?
For a hot second, that's what they wanted to do. But songs are expensive, and so they could not negotiate rights to get that on an affordable basis, and they had to brainstorm in a meeting one day, and someone said, how about this Andrew Gold song? And that the Andrew Gold song was, I think, 1978, so it was already 7 years old at that point. And so they listened to the lyrics and said, perfect. Had it re-recorded by this woman, a session singer named Cynthia Fee, and the rest is history. Her version has eclipsed the original and become the version that we all love.
Of course. It wouldn't be the same, would it, with a different theme song? Golden Girls Forever.
It really wouldn't.
An unauthorized look behind the lanai is out now, and it's available from Amazon.com. Jim Colucci, thank you so much for joining us. You're a star.
Yeah.